He said, very useful, the work that you have done
together. Our next speaker is Professor Antonio Lieto, and it's my real pleasure to read the introduction that I prepared based on his signature in his email. Antonio Lieto is a tenure-track senior researcher assistant professor in computer science at the Department of Computer Science at the University of Turin, a research associate at ICAR CNR Institute in Palermo, in Cognitive Robots and Social Sciences Lab, vice president of the Italian Association of Cognitive Sciences, deputy editor-in-chief of JET AI, Journal of Experimental and Theoretical Artificial Intelligence, associate editor for Cognitive Systems Research, ACM distinguished speaker by the ACM Association for Computing Machinery, and finally, the author of the new book came out this year, Cognitive Design for Artificial Minds. Welcome, Antonio, and please share your screen and go ahead.
Okay, so thank you very much, Alexey, for the introduction. I'm trying to share the screen. I'm facing some problems. Let's see. Okay, I will try to fix it now. Let me check.
Do you see the
okay? Okay. I had to change the permissions of my laptop. I have to go out from the meeting and then come back in and should work everything. Okay.
Well, I thought I gave you permission, but okay.
Okay.
As you wish. So meanwhile, Rosario, maybe you can say a few words about our keynote speaker.
Yes, Antonio, that I suggest to all the participants to read his book because it's an interesting perspective about the cognitive model. Antonio is a very expert in his field and he is trying to give his important personal contribution to the theory that is behind the creation of artificial intelligence cognitive model. And also Antonio Lieto is he gave a great contribution to bigger society with his works and all the work that is made.
Okay.
Antonio, I was speaking about you and I gave another introduction about your work.
Thank you, Rosario.
Thank you very much. Okay, I should be able now to, let's see, do this. Okay, now hopefully you're going to to see my screen.
Yes, right? I do.
Okay, so first of all, thank you very much, Alexey, for the invitation. Today I'm going to talk about some of the topics that are mainly covered in this book that just came out last April and that tries to, let's say, introduce and explain also to, let's say, early researchers, the ground of cognitively inspired AI and biological inspired AI and the kind of role that system built with a cognitively inspired or a biological inspired approach have in the process and in the context of both developing new technologies and in the context of trying to understand how our mind and our brain work. So in a nutshell, the idea is comes from the this epistemological loop, which is taken from the apparatus coming from the cybernetics, where the idea is to try to build an artificial system by taking inspiration from a natural system from the theory that we know about some cognitive phenomena of a natural system. And this is one part of the story. The second part of the story is that we, the kind of simulation or the kind of embodied agents that we are going to build, we also want to play a role back. We want to provide a sort of reverse inference, an explanatory inference with respect to how that system actually works. So we want to discover by a simulation some hidden mechanism of how our brain and our mind works for certain specific tasks or within integrated contexts. So this is the overall framework. But of course, in order to provide, to build models that have this kind of explanatory capacity, we have to first distinguish two different classes of artificial models of cognition. So in general of artificial system. The first class corresponds to the so-called functional system. So functional systems are artificial systems that share with a corresponding natural system that is able to perform the same kind of behavior, the same input-output specification, so they can process the same kind of input-output, and have only very weak resemblance of the internal components and of the internal mechanism between between them. So the idea is that the artificial, the algorithms that provide and that detail the a given behavior are only weakly resembling the ones that the kind of heuristics that we know from the theory about a biological system, and also the way in which the components are assembled is also, let's say, functionally related to the natural system that is taken as a source of inspiration. So the importance here is to have the same input-output specification. Then the processes, how this, output is obtained, is considered less important. And I would say that this is the main, design paradigm of modern AI research. On the other hand, if we want to have systems that are able to provide some sort of explanation of reverse inference with respect to, the way in which our brain or our mind work, we need the so-called structuralist models. And in this kind of models, the importance is not only to have for an artificial system the same input-output specification of the natural system, but also it is important to take into account how this output is produced given the input that is received. So also the way in which the components of the system are assembled and the algorithms that are developed are integrated together and are, chosen in order to provide a given function have a crucial role. And of course, I mean, we can see, and this is the kind of models that I think are interesting in the context of cognitive modeling and cognitively inspired AI. Of course, we can think at these two classes of models as, extremes of a continuum. This means that between a purely functional system and a pure, structural system, we can have in the middle a variety of different models, different systems that have different degrees of, cognitive or biological accuracy, and that therefore can be used to provide different kinds of explanations. You can see some of them here: functional explanation, evolutionistic explanation, or teleological explanation, or causal explanation, and so on and so forth. So these systems which are in between can provide different classes of explanation back to, the theory that we know about a natural system and about the cognitive phenomenon that we want to also model somehow within an artificial system. Now, a contribution that is available in the book and that I offer to the community is a method to actually provide a ranking, a link, okay, that can be quantitative and qualitative between the different classes of systems that we can develop, and also within the BICA community that tries to replicate or emulate a given Conti function or a variety of Conti function within a single cognitive cognitive systems. And in particular, this criterion is an evaluation framework that allows for both a quantitative and qualitative analysis about the cognitive adequacy or the biological adequacy as well, and the human-like performances of artificial system in both, let's say, narrow settings and also multitasking settings. It is minimal because it only requires to take into account these three elements that you can see below, which are the functional structural ratio. Because of course, in a complex system, like for example, a cognitive architecture, we have some elements that can be functionally replicated and some other elements which are more structurally constrained with respect to the natural system that we take as a source of inspiration. So this element, this ratio, tell us about what is the, the kind of cognitive or biological adequacy that we can, upon which we can ground the evaluation of the output that is provided by our system. The second element is the generality. So how many tasks are we able to solve with this kind of, unique architecture? This is another, important element. And the final one is the performance match. That in this framework is not, only intended as a measure of the success, okay? Because currently in AI, the only thing that is measured is, how your system is successful with respect to how humans, for example, perform the same kind of task. Here, in order to evaluate the human likeness of an artificial system, the important thing is also to evaluate the errors of the systems and the response time, for example, that are taken, that are executed by the implemented algorithms with respect to the response times that we also have in the context of cognitive and experimental psychology. So the idea is to take into account also, the full spectrum of the psychometric measures that also can really shed lights about the cognitive adequacy of the system that we are going to build, and therefore can tell us how much we can, attribute an explanation, a reverse, inference, and therefore a kind of explanation that we can, return back to the theory, to about the phenomenon of the natural system that we want to model in our artificial one. So this is, I think, an important element in general of the overall framework proposed in the book. And what I'll try to, and it is important because it allows us to, rank, to actually quantitatively and qualitatively rank the different kinds of artificial systems that are developed both in the AI literature and in the context of cognitive science and computational cognitive science literature. For example, we know we can use this kind of framework to see to say that, for example, system like IBM Watson or the AlphaGo system by DeepMind, they are not Conti systems. As you can see, they are not Conti system, and the fact that they are not Conti system is not due to the kind of, modeling approach that they use, because, for example, IBM Watson use a symbolic probabilistic approach, while DeepMind use actually a connectionist deep learning frameworks. So this is, the kind of modeling paradigm used is not, a feature in the evaluation of the human likeness, of the system, because it only tell us which is the level of details to which our model is focused on. But this is very pragmatic tool that allows us to distinguish when the label cognitive computing is used in a misplaced way, as it is in the case of this kind of system. And of course, it also allows to rank the different kind of architectures and system according to their level of biological and of cognitive accuracy. Now I will take this preamble for granted from the rest for the rest of the presentation, and then I will go back to this point after I'm going to present these two case studies that refers to a specific problem, because in the last years I've been focused on a specific problem, which is an open problem in both AI and cognitive science, which concerns the problem of common sense reasoning. Problem of common sense reasoning was recognized already by Marvin Minsky as one of the, crucial element to solve in order to build agents able to have a general intelligence, and it was considered the sort of grounding layers, the grounding element between different layers of intelligence in order to leverage, start from the low level signals and go to the social intelligence kind of behavior. This was one of the main motivation of my focus on this problem. And I'll try to connect this second part of the talk, which is mainly about my contribution to this topic, with respect to the previous part, which was more an introduction about some of the framework that we followed in following the cognitively inspired AI community. So first of all, what is common sense reasoning? Well, a first characterization can be done in this way. We can say that common sense reasoning in both humans and machines concerns all the type of non-deductive or non-monotonic inferences, like induction, abduction, default reasoning, and so on and so forth. But the point is that this kind of logic-based characterization is not enough to really characterize what we really mean for common sense reasoning, because the crucial element is the notion of typicality, which is borrowed from the work done by Eleanor Roche in the field of cognitive psychology. So the idea is that typical inductions are common sense inferences, or typical abductions are common sense inferences, but not all, for example, the type of abductive inferences can be considered as common sense inferences. I will show you in a minute what I really mean with induction, with typicality, because there are different theories of typicality that have been developed so far in the context of cognitive science and that we have modeled in our system. So this is a first crucial aspect of the entire theme of common sense reasoning that we have to take into account if you want to really build human-like systems in terms of their ability of performing common sense reasoning inferences. The second point to take into account is the notion of compositionality, which is an irrevocable trait of human cognition. It is a crucial generative requirement. So the idea of building blocks, which can be in this kind of compositional way. Now, why this element is problematic in common sense reasoning? It is problematic because there is this paradigmatic problem, which is called the pet fish problems, that tell us that typical representations, so prototypes, are not compositional. So this is an example that you can see here. If you consider to have the prototype, so the typical representation of what is a pet with typical features that are associated to a pet, and what is a fish with the typical features associated to a fish, and then you want to generate the pet fish, you see that the generated pet fish does not, is not merely composed by the additive inclusion of the typical features of the two corresponding concepts. And there are also some additional features like the fact of being red that was not originally available in any of the two composing concepts. Now, This example is paradigmatic because this is how our cognition work when we invent, when we generate new concepts, new knowledge by combining the knowledge that we already have in our long-term memory or in our short-term memory in order to solve certain classes of goals. So my research has been focused on these two areas, these two sub-problems within the overall, let's say, umbrella of common sense reasoning. So typicality and common sense compositionality. And I've tackled these problems by considering different levels of representation within these tripartite, let's say, cognitive architectures that was proposed some years ago with Antonio Kella and Marcello Frizione. In particular, I will show you how the notion of, let's say, in particular, common sense reasoning, common sense typicality, in particular, typicality-based categorization can be handled by considering the, let's say, an integration between a particular type of vector space model and classical, let's say, symbolic formalism, while the problem of common sense compositionality has been solved by proposing a new probabilistic logical framework combining, let's say, numerical elements and standard symbolic formalism. So let's start with the first problem, with the problem of typicality. As I was mentioning, let's say, in the context of quantity science, there are different theories of typicality. The first one that I already mentioned is the one introduced by Lenoir Roche, according to which concepts in our mind are organized in terms of prototypes. So this means that there is a central element of the category, which is the most important one from a cognitive point of view. Like, for example, in the concept of birds, the prototype is represented by the robin. And this kind of, let's say, assumed configurational infrastructure has also some implications about the reasoning perspectives and the kind of actions that can be performed of this kind of representation. For example, an assumption is that when we have to categorize a new item to assess the to which kind of category this item belongs to, we compare the new item with the prototypes. So with only, let's say, the central element of a category. And now, this theory was important because it explained many kinds of typicality effects in categorization, but it was somehow superseded in the following years, in the 80s and in the 90s, by another theory that explained other kinds of typicality effects. And in particular, this theory is called as exemplar-based theory, according to which our concepts are organized around, let's say, few, let's say, exemplars that we have actually, for example, really perceived, or that we with which we have had any kind of also, let's say, imaginary contact in our mind. Like, for example, for the concept of cat, the category of cat is assumed to be represented by six, seven, let's say, representative elements of this category, with which we have probably shared some experience in our during our lifetime. Now, this kind of representational assumption, as I also said for the prototypes, have some implications when we want to use this representation for reasoning purposes. Because in this case, for example, when a new item has to be categorized, this new item is compared not with the prototype, because there isn't a prototype, but it is compared with every indice of these, let's say, examples of the categories. And this is what characterized the assessment of the category-based assignment. Now, the important thing here is that prototypes and exemplars explain different aspects of typicality. So they are theories that were originally seen as conflicting theories, but they are actually able to explain diverse aspects of the typicality effects of categorization. For example, in the exemplar theory explains why when there is an element in our long-term memory that of which we already had an experience, this exemplar is always retrieved first with respect to the prototype of the same category. So this explains the so-called old item effect. So on this aspect, the exemplar theory had better evidences with respect to the prototype theory. However, there were situations in which the exemplar theory were able to explain in a more sophisticated and exact way what was going on with the results coming from the human data. But I think that the turning point is this work by Barbara Malt in the late 80s that shows how we as humans are actually able to integrate different kind of representation for the same concept. So the idea is that we can have prototype-based representation, exemplar-based representation, or other kinds of theory-like and, let's say, classical-based representation. So this last assumption was the one that we followed for the realization of the system dual packs that tackle the problem of typicality. And this is an acronym that stands for prototype and exemplar-based conceptual categorization system. And the system it is a structural system. And I will try to explain you why, because it relies on two, let's say, strong constraints about the way in which this typicality-based categorization is assumed. First, there is the idea that we have multiple representation for the same concept. Second, there is the idea that on such diverse kind of representation, we can actually execute different types of reasoning. In particular, system one reasoning, which are the more data-driven one, fast, in the Kahneman terminology, and then we can also integrate this kind of data-driven reasoning and fast reasoning with more logical and deliberative types of reasoning and categorization assumption. So from a practical point of view, we devised a system with a hybrid knowledge base where the classical component was, let's say, built by using the OpenSci ontology, which is one of the widest ontological and general ontological resources available on the web, with more than 200 and thousands concepts and relation between these concepts. And this was, let's say, taken to represent the classical type of information. So the information upon which you can, let's say, use deductive rules to make categorization. Like, for example, if we consider the concept of water, we can say that the classical part of information of water is the fact that water is everything that is composed by two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. So this kind of classical representation that is encoded in the ontology, along with a taxonomical information, allows to us to directly assign a new data point to the class of water, if and only if, let's say, the data point that we want to categorize share the necessary and sufficient condition to belong to the class. On the other hand, we have the typicality-based component in which we have represented both prototypes and exemplar. In particular, for the typicality-based component, we have used the conceptual spaces framework, which is a particular type of vector space model introduced by Peter Yardenfors, where, let's say, concepts have a geometrical interpretation. And in this kind of context, it is natural to, let's say, model prototypes as, let's say, centroids within these spaces, while exemplar can be also modeled as, let's say, data points in these spaces. And there are different kinds of similarity metrics that can be used to make non-monotonic inferences and fast categorization. So fast assignment also of categorization for new items. So the interesting thing is that this kind of integration was not done ad hoc, but we used an external library, let's say in particular WordNet, which is a very well-known lexical database for English, to integrate this kind of knowledge infrastructure. In particular, for the part of the vectorial knowledge basis, WordNet, the WordNet identifiers were assigned by combining, by integrating different resources like BubbleNet and ConceptNet. And on the other end, for the ontological component, for the classical component, this kind of element was already the OpenSite ontology that we use was already aligned with the WordNet identifiers. In this way, it was possible for us to switch from one representation to another within the same concept and to execute different types of reasoning depending on the kind of, let's say, sub-representation that we were considering of the same kind of concept. So typical representation or classical forms of representation. And we devised integrated dual process-based categorization algorithm that I will try to explain a little bit in the following. So the idea is that the system was composed by this kind of hybrid integrated knowledge infrastructure. And in this way, we devised a system that was able to answer to simple common sense queries that were something like riddles. This is a task that is commonly also called the word reasoning, because it is not a task of retrieval, but it is a task for which, in order to to obtain to retrieve the correct concept from the knowledge base that you have to perform some reasoning steps, and this was the pipeline that we devised in our system. There was an input a linguistic description, like which is the big carnivore with yellow and black stripes. Okay, this is a typical query, a common sense query. We devised a standard information extraction procedure with finite state machines that allowed us to build, let's say, a kind of vector query that was later on launched on the first vectorial counterpart of the knowledge base, and then checked on the second ontological counterpart. This example should be more clear. So the idea is that after the information extraction step, in this case, the query was, which is the big fish that eats plankton? After the creation of this vector query and after the check of the similarity between the vector query and the vectorial knowledge base composed by conceptual spaces that allowed us to represent typical information, the first fast result that is provided is the result of the conceptual space component. And in this case, for example, the first result is the concept of whale, is the prototype of whale. Why? Because whale share with a fish all the typical features, right? So they live in the water, they, for example, in this case also eats plankton and so on and so forth. However, the second check, the check done with the ontological knowledge base, which is slower, allows to tell to the system, well, look, that whales are not fishes, they are mammals, so we have to revise somehow the first answer that you retrieved in the first stance. So in this way, we were able to have to integrate these different kinds of reasoning, which is exactly what we have also in human cognitive system. And this system was integrated. This is a demo, like for the query, which is the big fish with very sharp teeth. Okay. And this system was integrated with a number of cognitive architectures by extending de facto their knowledge level abilities. In this context, in this case, you see the integration with the ACTAR cognitive architectures. So here you see how the request is transformed in after the information extraction step, where the sentence is parsed. Actually, there is a transformation of the query in a standard ACTAR model, And after this translation in the ACTAR model, what we have is that the system first ran its system one representation, and you see it is instantaneous. So the first information that is extracted is the concept of shark in this case, and then and this concept becomes already immediately available in the working memory of the ACTAR cognitive architectures. So this means that the system can act and react in real time by performing in the meanwhile, while waiting for the S2 response's other task. But then there is also the check that goes in parallel with this procedure coming from the S2 ontology. And in this case, the result is consistent, so there is not the need to revise the previous answer. So as I mentioned, this kind of dual process based hybrid knowledge representation architecture was integrated with ACTAR, LIDA, SOAR, and Clarion. So architectures having different representational assumption, the system is available online, and was of course also evaluated in the context of a comparison with humans. And from this kind of comparison, we saw that we had we measured the concept accuracy, concept categorization accuracy. So how much the right concept is retrieved by our system with respect to, let's say, human performances, but also how much the right representation, so prototype or exemplar or, let's say, classical representation, is retrieved with respect to the human's answer. And we have, let's say, a pretty good accuracy measures for both these details. But as I mentioned, it was important for us, in order to have let's say also an explanatory power with respect to the theory that we had implemented in our design phase for building the system, also to look at the errors. So, and we realized that most of the errors that were done by our system were in the correct identification of the right representation to retrieve. So the retrieved overall concept was right, but in most of the cases we retrieved an exemplar, while on the other end the an exemplar of that concept, of the right concept, but while the humans retrieved the prototype of that concept. So this happened, because we implemented the so-called old item effect heuristics, according to which, if let's say you have an exemplar which is in this hybrid knowledge base, which is similar enough to the stimulus to categorize, the exemplar is always retrieved with respect to the prototype. So this was one of the reasons of our, let's say, main success, but also one of the reasons of our main failures when we analyzed the errors. So this kind of performance match analysis allowed us to reveal that it is not always true that exemplars, if similar enough to the new data point to categorize, are always preferred with respect to the prototypes, which is what it was predicted by the theory that we implemented in our system. So in this case, the output, the analysis of the output, was able to provide a feedback to, let's say, to the theoretical part, to people doing work in quantum psychology and experimental psychology, by telling that they had to look a little bit in a more, let's say, close way, these kind of elements, in order to, let's say, also deal with this problem also within the realization of an artificial system. So the idea is that we need a more fine-grained theory explaining the interaction between possible coexisting representation within the heterogeneous hypothesis that is what we considered in this kind of system. So this is, let's say, one part of the story is related to the prototype. And as I mentioned, the dual pack system, which is a structurally built system, was able to provide also this kind of reverse inference, not only to provide this kind of technological advancement in terms of having a system that is able to perform different kinds of human-like categorization. The other point that we tackled is the problem of common sense compositionality, which is exactly the pet fish problem that I explained you at the beginning of the talk. Now, in common sense compositionality, we see that the current deep learning system don't work so well. And this is these are some examples taken from the paper from Lake and colleagues, where the idea here is that the system had to caption some images, so they had to understand, so to compose somehow the entire semantics of a scene. And as you can see from the caption, I mean, it is evident that such systems are not really able to understand what is going on. I mean, for example, consider the picture of the airplane. So the caption generated is an airplane which is parked on the tarmac at an airport, okay? Also the picture of in the extreme right, which is also captioned as a group of people standing the top of a beach. So it's very strange. So there is this system don't work well in dealing with the common sense compositionality, and this is also true for system like GPT-3. I think that you all of us have seen these. This screenshot in other occasions. This is a system developed by OpenAI, according to which, given a prompt for a story, the system was able to automatically complete and generate a plausible story for a human reader. This is a story about unicorns in South America and so on and so forth. So this was taken by deep learning people as a proof that their system were actually able to do common sense compositionality, but this assumption is really not grounded on anything, because the problem is that kind of test in which GPT-3 is a test completion test. So test completion test is a prediction test, which is exactly what the neural networks and deep learning system are good at. It is not a test of compositionality. In particular, there are some preliminary works that show how also GPT-3, which is one of the last large, language models used, have the very same problems that also the previous system had in understanding and in doing common sense reasoning, as you can see from this excerpt from this preliminary evaluation done by Davis and Marcus. So deep learning systems are not able to deal with problems like common sense compositionality, like the pet fish problem, which is a crucial problem because it is actually the way in which we generate new things. Okay, so to tackle this problem, introduced a probabilistic non-monotonic description logic, which is called TCL, typicality-based concept combination, which integrates these three ingredients. I have not time to go into the details of all the semantics of this logic, but I will try to give you the main idea, and I will try to connect, the results of this system with the first part of the discourse about structural and functional system. So these logics connect a description logic of typicality with probabilities and distributed semantics. And in a nutshell, it allows to have a probabilistic knowledge basis that allows to assert facts like there is a probability P, or we believe with a probability P that typical Cs are also D. Like, for example, we believe with a probability 0.8 that typical students are also social media users, and so on and so forth. Of course, these probabilities can be learned from the environment. So this is the connection with the numerical part. In addition, in order to use this this kind of integrated probabilistic logic in the context of common sense concept combination, we use the cognitive heuristics coming from cognitive semantics, according to which when there are two or more concepts to be combined in order to form a new concept in a knowledge base, there is always an add and one or modifier, one of more modifiers. So the idea is that we want to inherit more features from the head and less from the modifier. So we introduced, we integrated this element also in our probabilistic logic, and we were able to provide in this way a full reasoning pipeline, where starting from a knowledge base with real data, because you can associate probabilities to typical features. Okay, and we also can include, let's say, rigid assertions. So assertions that are valid for all the instances of a class, not only for typical instances. You can generate all the 2 to the power of n probabilistic scenarios of the concepts to be combined in the concept combination task. And then you can, let's say, use the cognitive, the add and modify heuristics to select the scenarios which respect this kind of rule. So we select the scenarios, the composed scenarios that have higher probabilities, but that also respect the cognitive heuristic of head and modifier. And we showed in the paper that was mentioned before how in this way we were able to model the pet fish problem. And we were also, this was also just the starting point, because once we were able to model this fundamental problem, we also showed how it was possible to use this kind of inference engine to model other quantitative modeling problems, like the Linda problem, also known as the conjunction fallacy problem. But we also showed how this system was could have been used in the context of intelligent applications, like in the context of the automatic generation of characters. So, for example, in the concept of computational creativity, or in the context of the automatic recommendation of new genres for certain users. This was the result of a work done in collaboration with the Centro Ricerche RAI. RAI is the main broadcasting public Italian company. We showed how once we were able to model this foundational element, we were able to also apply this kind of inference engine to a variety of application. One application that I want to show you, and then I will conclude, is an application concerning the task of goal-oriented knowledge generation and problem solving. So the idea is that given a knowledge base, which is expressed in the TCL logic, this kind of probabilistic logic, and even a goal that an agent has to solve, the agent has different strategies that can be used. So the first strategy is try to see whether in its knowledge base it already has the knowledge to solve the problem that it wants to solve. If this is not the case, then the agent can use the combinatorial engine of the TCL logic in order to generate new knowledge that can allows it to solve the original problem that he was not able to previously solve. Of course, this is an iterative process. Okay, so the idea is that you can reach the conclusions in different steps, and we test this kind of problem in the problem of object composition. So how the idea is to see whether how given a goal to solve, the system was able to select objects to compose in order to generate a novel object that was able to solve that original goal. This is a complex task because only humans and other, let's say, few primates and, for example, ravens are able to invent new objects by combining them. So this is a complex task for biological species. And this is, for example, the kind of goal that we tested. So the idea was to, for example, goal one says that we want an object that is able to cut and that is graspable. We want an object that is graspable and that is also able to launch other objects and distance and so on and so forth. So this was the way in which the goals were expressed. And below you see the way in which the knowledge base, the probabilistic knowledge base, is composed in our system. So on the right you see the way in which it is actually implemented. On the left you see how it is conceived in our original logic. But for example, let's try to see a little bit what happens for this goal. So the idea is to ask the system to find an object that is graspable and is able to launch other objects at distance. This is the way in which the probabilistic knowledge base of objects is composed. So once the system is launched, the first thing that it tries to do is try to see whether there is an element in the knowledge base that is already let's say usable to solve the problem. In this case, there is any element that has these features. So the system creates dynamically new knowledge by combining the concept in the knowledge base that allows him to integrate these features that we want to reach. And in this case, it suggests to compose the concept of rubber band with the concept of branch in order to form a sort of a slingshot, okay? So this is the way in which, let's say, the system interacted and created this new concept. Also here, we had an evaluation with humans for the same kind of task, the task of object creation, object combination. We had a good degree of overlapping, but still we realized and we saw in our evaluation that the humans are able to provide more answers than the systems. So the top answers actually matched the answer of the humans, but then the humans were able to provide more alternatives. Okay. Okay, so this means that they were able to also recombine in a more ways the kind of common sense knowledge, implicit knowledge that they had about this kind of objects. Interestingly, also this system was, we showed how it was possible to integrate this system in the context of SOAR, cognitive architectures, in order to extend its knowledge, let's say, sub-goaling procedures. We know that in SOAR, the subgoaling is one of the main, the universal subgoaling is one of the main procedures for, let's say, problem solving and planning. So we show how one of the elements that could be added to this architecture to extend the capabilities of the architecture could come from our TCL reasoning framework. And coming back to, let's say, the first part of the presentation, I think that it should be now clear, at least more clear, how by using the minimal cognitive grid, it is possible to and to collocate between this functional structural continuum the two systems that I have presented here. So dual packs is more on the structural continuum because it makes more assumption. A more cognitively grounded assumption with respect to the way in which the system has been designed, with respect to the way in which its output can be interpreted with respect to, let's say, the theory of the natural system that were taken into account, while TCL has a less explanatory power, but it is, let's say, more oriented in the context of functional system, because the only kind of heuristics, cognitive heuristic that employs is the head modifier heuristics, but it is more a functional system. So it is important to take into account this differentiation, I think, in our community, because otherwise we run the risk of attributing cognitive faculty or cognitive explanation to systems which do not really have any kind of explanatory role to play. So upshots, I've showed how cognitively inspired AI can really play still a crucial role for the development of the next generation of AI system. Have shown how, two different kinds of cognitively inspired AI system can address at the different levels of representation some crucial requirements of common sense reasoning, which are typicality and the capability of composing, of common sense compositionality. And I've also tried to show you how such structural, such system have been integrated with diverse general cognitive architectures, thus extending de facto their categorization and reasoning capabilities. This system, there is a typo here in the slide, are not both structural, but one is functional and another one is structural. And I've tried to show you which is the role that they can play in both, let's say, the development of intelligent applications and cognitive models having an explanatory purposes. So thank you very much for your attention. Here I've listed some references and I'm ready for taking questions.
Thank you very much, Antonio, for your keynote. Yes, please, does anybody have any questions?
If I can ask a question, first of all, thank you, Antonio, for a really interesting presentation. Lecturers, you mentioned it at one time using WordNet as your source. What sort of information from WordNet did you use it? Just synsets or hypernemy too?
Yeah, okay. So thank you very much for the for this question. It is a very relevant one, but I didn't have time to go into the details. I just used the synsets because the synset already, I mean, WordNet already provides you with the synset that have, let's say, a different semantics for every and each word. And I used WordNet as a grounding element for the different synsets of a term. And while from let's say the semantic ontology ontological component, I'll try to show you here. Okay, while from the ontological component, it was or the WordNet identifier were already assigned to the classes of the ontologies and to the properties and so on and so forth. For the vectorial counterpart, I have integrated these two resources, which is BubbleNet, which is a huge, let's say, multilingual resource developed by Roberto Navigli. This is I used the let's say, vectorial counterpart of BubbleNet, which is called Nazari, which is a huge distributional semantics based linguistic resource, and I filtered this kind equipped with the WordNet ID, but I filtered this kind of resource with ConceptNet, which provides only from 30 to 40 features, common sense features for every and each concept. ConceptNet it is the result of a crowdsourcing project done at MIT, where every and each concept was let's say manually annotated by thousands of people. And so the result of ConceptNet is really a synthetic version of what is really typical, typically associated to a concept. So in this way, with this integration, we were able to have a low level, let's say a linguistic resource equipped with WordNet IDs, but with low dimensionality. And in this way, we were able to also connect, of course, the same WordNet ID with the corresponding class of WordNet. And this allowed us this flexibility of passing from one kind of representation to another. But this representation were just different ways of talking about the same concept. Like in the example of water, you find in the ontology, the classical, let's say, representation. And in the typical representation, you find the information that typically waters are available in a liquid state, are colorless, are odorless. These are all typical elements, are not, let's say, necessary or sufficient conditions for being, let's say, categorized as such an element. But yeah, this is the way in which we use the linguistic resource WordNet.
Yeah, thank you. In my experience, we worked with WordNet and ConceptNet too. There was one paper on the previous beak and one about the problems of ConceptNet too. In this time, our experience is that synsets are only good part of WordNet because hypernemy is highly unsystematic and have a lot of problems there. FrameNet is much better for hypernemic ontological relations than WordNet. And ConceptNet is actually also highly unsystematic and a very low source because it has a lot of random facts without any connections between them. A dog can win a blue ribbon. How about a red ribbon? Oops, sorry, nothing. And so a lot of similar relationships. And most important, it hardly can be used for conclusions. There are no difference between what can and what can't. Just some random facts that can. ConceptNet actually need a lot more work to become a usable source of knowledge.
Yeah. I mean, I agree with your point. Indeed, we are trying to also extend these elements to FrameNet. But you know, the coverage of FrameNet is very low. While on the other hand, we were able in this way to ground, to have this kind of integrated, knowledge-based system with the general knowledge, because we are able to, the system is able to answer to queries of on different domains. So it is general enough to take that kind of queries for different domains. And that's why we decided to integrate these resources, which had a wider coverage. But I agree that there are the problems that you are mentioning. We are trying to integrate also other resources like FrameNet that you were mentioning. Also, because probably FrameNet is more aligned also to the theoretical underpinnings of the typicality of what is. What typically happens, for example, in a situation or corresponding to an action and so on and so forth. So our approach is to integrate additional resources and not, throw out, the baby with the bad water. So we will keep this infrastructure, but we will try to integrate other resources in order to minimize the kind of errors that you were mentioning about negation and about all this stuff.
Okay, we are a bit over time, but let me please ask you one short question. What is your definition of a cognitive system? Yes, because you said that neural networks and symbolic AI are not cognitive systems.
No, I didn't say that. I said that IBM Watson and the AlphaGo system are not cognitive system. Why they're not cognitive system? Because they cannot play any kind of explanatory role with respect to the way in which we as humans are able to, deal with the same kind of problem. So performing question answering or playing, for example, to the game of Go. So a cognitive system is a system that has an explanatory role. We have seen that there are different levels of explanations that we can attribute to different degrees of a structurally valid system. Okay, but the point is that you have to have to provide this kind of you should be able to provide this kind of reverse inference with respect to the way in which we. Are able to solve the same class of problems if you want to, have this kind of labels. I mean, I have nothing against IBM Watson and AlphaGo. They are very good AI technologies, but they are these companies, for example, IBM is selling this technology as a cognitive computing technologies. And so they are just using for marketing purposes this misleading label. That is not correct, because if you want to have this kind of, a quantity system assumption, you not only have to build a good technology, but you also should be able to provide these, explanatory inference with respect to the elements that you are trying to understand.
Okay, but still, do you have a short definition of a cognitive system?
Yeah, this is the short definition. A cognitive system is an artificial system that is able to provide not only the same input-output specification of a natural system, but it also work in a way that is similar to the natural system that is taken eventually as a source of inspiration. If there is this connection, you can provide this reverse inference, this explanatory inference. Otherwise, you cannot use, you cannot claim that your system is a really a cognitive system. It is an AI system, but it is not a cognitive system.
Thank you very much. Any last question from anybody? Okay, I guess we are over time and need to move forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great talk. Thanks a lot.